would be a tragedy for me to turn away. All my needs you have supplied. When I was dead, you gave me life. How could I not give it away so freely? And I'll follow you into the homes of the broken. I'll follow you into the world.
You are
who is able to keep us, able to keep us from falling to the only God. Be all glory and honor, majesty and power, for all ages now and forevermore. To the only and honor, majesty and power, for all ages now and forevermore.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. We want to give a special welcome to all of our first-time viewers out there. If this is your first time viewing our broadcast, we're asking those of you out there, just share and like our broadcast on Facebook or YouTube. Let your family and friends know that this broadcast is going. We're sure that we'll share something tonight that will be a blessing to them. We want to go to the Lord in prayer tonight. So let's bow our heads real quickly. Father, we do thank you for your grace and your mercy. We thank you for this opportunity to come before your people. We thank you, Father, for all those who are gathered together online, wherever they may be watching this broadcast. We pray for them. We pray that your spirit, your presence will be right where they are. Wherever they are, we pray that your presence will be there. We pray that you would minister to them grace and encouragement and healing and strength. Father, build them up on their most holy faith. We thank you, Father, in advance for wisdom and understanding. Lord, open the eyes of our understanding. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear. We trust that you would grant us these things in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Again, we're excited again to be able to come back and bring another broadcast right into your home. Today, we're going to do something a little differently today. Let me ask you this question. How many of you out there got a chance to catch our video on Thursday? We did a throwback Thursday video last week. You may have had an opportunity to catch that video if you were paying attention to the notifications on Facebook. On last Thursday, we went into the vault and pulled out an old sermon video, and it came back a lot of comments, a lot of good reviews. So what we decided to do today was go back into that vault and grab another one of these old sermons. Actually, it's another installment, another sermon in the series that we showed on last Thursday. We're talking about faith in this sermon. And those of you who are new to our broadcast or new to our ministry, you'll get a chance to see Pastor with a little bit more hair this time. Not much, but a little bit more. This video is taken back. I mean, it's going back to early 2000s. And so I hope you enjoy this sermon like many of you enjoyed last sermon. And just stay on the broadcast. We'll come back after this. Check this out again. We're calling this sermon Prepare by Faith. This was a sermon series that we did on faith back in 2009. So I hope you enjoy it.
Hebrews chapter 11. We've been looking through this particular chapter, slowly going through the verses, because we have been trying to answer the question, what is faith, or what faith is. And we've been gaining a lot of insight as it relates to faith. We've looked at all the verses through verse 6. We come now to verse 7. And I'm not sure if we're going to hit each one of these verses through this chapter, so I don't want to set anybody up for disappointment. I'm just telling you in advance. We're just kind of following the Spirit. But we come now to verse 7. Excuse me. Verse 7 says, by faith Noah, being warned of God of the things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the salvation of his house. Let's read that again, just that much. By faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house. Now, the last time we were together, we were discussing Enoch. And as it says in verse 5, let's look back at verse 5. It says, by faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death and was not found because God had translated him. We said to you that translation, or to be translated, means to change positions. In Enoch's case, it meant going from earth to glory. And the Lord translated him, not the conventional way through death, but passing death, changing positions, going from death or a life of death to a life of eternal life. And he was translated, and he was, if you go back to Genesis and look at the account, he was born just prior to the flood. And he escaped the flood. He only lived 365 days. It's interesting that the man who was said to walk with God lived for 365 days. Gives you the idea that that's how many days we ought to be spending walking with God, 365, every day of our life. He only lived 365 days when everybody else in during that time was living 900, 800 years. His life was cut short because he was translated. He escaped the coming judgment, the coming flood, by being translated. And he was translated because he walked with God. And most of us would like that kind of salvation. Would like that kind of deliverance that brings you immediate results. You don't have to go through the storm, you just leap over it. That's translation. And God does that. By faith, your faith can bring you into deliverance just like that, without going through the conventional way. But then we read in the next passage in verse 7 of Hebrews 11, that here is a man who also walked with God. Go back to Genesis chapter 6. Did you not know that Noah also walked with God? And I believe the Lord put this in here so we wouldn't have the wrong idea. We're not all going to be translated. We're not all going to escape trouble miraculously. Sometimes, like the Hebrew boys, you're going to have to go through the fire, through the flood. Genesis 6 and verse 9. These are the generations of Noah. Noah was a just man. Was he just? Was he holy? Noah was a just man, and perfect in his generation. And Noah walked with God. The same testimony that Enoch had. Enoch walked with God. Noah walked with God. I'm sure Noah wanted to know, why can't I be translated? Why can't I have an immediate deliverance? Why I gotta go through this time of trouble? Why can't I just escape this situation? Don't I walk with God? Am I not pleasing with you? You see, a lot of times we think the reason why we're not escaping certain things is because we're not walking with God. You can walk with God and you still got to go through. Translation is not in your future. Escape is not in your future. Faith not only brings translation, sometimes faith demands that we participate in our salvation. Go back to Hebrews chapter 11. And this is what we're talking about, what faith is. It's not just an escape hatch. It's not just a portal from one life to another. But sometimes faith means preparation. You know, preparing. It says here in Hebrews 11 concerning Noah in verse 7, by faith, Noah, being warned of the things not yet seen. That's not really what his faith was being used for. That's a clause. The real point says, by faith, Noah prepared an ark. The words in between those are just clauses that just exemplifies or amplifies the particular verse he's speaking on. But he's, by faith, he used his faith to do what? Prepared an ark to the saving of his house. He prepared for his salvation. Enoch escaped, but Noah was forced to prepare for his salvation. Prepared for his salvation by his faith. And sometimes, like I said, the Lord will require us to participate in our salvation process. Go with me to James chapter 2. James, James chapter 2. By faith, Noah prepared for his salvation. By faith, he prepared for his salvation. Are you participating? Are you an active participant in your salvation? Or are you just sitting back and kind of letting God do all the work? Or hoping that God does all the work? You think, oh, I'm walking with him. I'm coming to church. I'm doing this. So just the Lord will do it all by himself. No, faith will often require that you participate in this process. Here in James chapter 2, James chapter 2, verse 14. What doth it profit, my brethren, though a man said he hath faith and have not works, can faith save him? Can faith save him? The obvious answer to that is no. That's the point the writer is trying to make. James is saying, look, it's great that you have faith. It's excellent that you put your trust in God. Excellent. But can your faith deliver you? That is, on its own. Faith without works is dead, which he says in verse 17. Jump down to verse 17. Even so, faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone. Faith without any corresponding action cannot save you. Faith will require you to participate in your salvation. In verse 22, jump down a bit. We're skipping around on quite a deal, but verse 22, it says, seest thou how faith wrought with works, and by works was faith made perfect. So what we need to realize, our works, our participation in faith is what makes our faith perfect. And that's what Noah was forced to do or commanded to do. Noah, you're not going to escape the way Enoch escaped. In order for you to be saved, you must participate in your salvation by preparing an ark. Your preparation, your works, is what's going to make your faith perfect. You know what the word perfect means? It means finished or complete. You know, salvation only comes at the end of faith. People wonder, where's my salvation? Is at the end of your faith. Look at 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 1. First Peter chapter 1. Whatever you're believing for, the thing you're believing for will not manifest until your faith has finished its work. At the end of your faith. It's like everything we believe God for has a faith assigned to it. That until that faith has finished its work, you cannot receive the promise. It comes at the end, not the beginning of believing, at the end of it. Here in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 9 tells us, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. Receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. Jesus said it this way in Matthew 24:13. He that endureth to the end shall be saved. Endure to the end. If your faith endures to the end of what? Well, only God knows that. The end of his testing, the end of his trial. When you get to the end, then you get the salvation. Well, how do you get to the end? Again, James tells us that doing good works completes, finishes faith. Faith is completed, it is finished by our good works. Go with me to Philippians chapter 2. You know, the word perfect back in James 2 and 22, it's the same word we read in Ephesians 6 and 13 when the Bible says, having done all to stand. The words having done all is the same word complete. Having done all to stand. And that's what our works are supposed to be doing. Finishing, doing everything that's asked of us. At the end of that, our faith is being made perfect. Here, Philippians, Paul puts it another way in Philippians chapter 2. Philippians 2 and verse 12. Wherefore, my brethren, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Work out. Finish. It's the same words. Finish. Bring to an end. Work to an end. Bring to completion your salvation. And who's given that responsibility? We are. Work out your own salvation, my brethren, with fear and trembling. Complete the work, in other words. Complete it. Finish it. We want God to just translate us, but sometimes God looks down at us and says, oh, Noah, finish what you started. Work it out, and if you do so, you and your whole house will be saved. You know, I'm convinced that the reason why we're not seeing the salvation, not only in our own life, but in the lives of our homes, is because we're not finishing. We've left things undone. Just search your heart right now. Just search your heart. And allow the Spirit to bring before your mind things that are left undone. You're given a responsibility. I'm given a responsibility to participate in our salvation. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. How are we going to do that? Verse 13 tells us, for it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. You know, Noah wasn't building that ark by himself. Noah didn't say, God says he's going to send a rain, a flood. I know what I'll do. I'll build an ark. He had no idea what an ark was. He was still turning over in his mind the whole idea of a flood. He'd never seen a flood. How do you explain a flood to someone who's probably never seen rain before? At this time in the earth history, God wasn't raining down. The Bible says the dew came up from the ground and watered the earth. You can imagine how ridiculous Noah's testimony had been to the inhabitants of the world that he lived in when he said it was going to rain even so much that it would flood. Try explaining that to a three-year-old who's never seen these kinds of things. In fact, Hebrews tells us that receiving a warning not yet seen. He said he hadn't seen this before. He was warned of something that he had never seen before. And so he had to lean on God. Lord, what do I do to prepare? He says, if you listen to me, you and your whole house will be saved. And that's what we are supposed to be doing. Do we believe the warning that God is coming not to destroy the earth by water, but by fire? Do we believe that warning? And are we also, like Noah, participating by faith? I know it looks like everything is cozy. Everything is going to continue as it always has been. But we need to, by faith, believe that there is coming a destruction. Believe the warning. And not just believe it and hope that God somehow miraculously takes us through this and translates us, raptures us out of the coming trouble. Just get us out of here, Lord. I know it's trouble coming on the earth, but I don't want to be here. Just translate me like Enoch. No, not for you, Noah. Others I've allowed to escape the sword. But this generation, you shall have to prepare for your own salvation. And remember, while you're building this, you and your family's got to be in this thing. This thing has got to take you to the end. No, it can't give halfway out and spring a hole and starts to leak. You're going to be in trouble. The faith that we're walking in now, it's got to take us through the trouble that's coming. A lot of us, we aren't preparing for the trouble because we don't expect to go through it. That's naive. You ought to prepare like Noah for the coming trouble. And the way you do that is by listening to God. He says it right here. Don't worry, I know you never built a boat before, but I've got it all in my mind. And not only do I have it all in my mind, he says, I've got it all in my power. And it's just something uncanny about me. I'm able to do what I want to, even through this weak vessel. He says in verse 13, he says, it is God which worketh in you both to will. See, he gave you the idea, you know what? I need to be working for my salvation. I need to be preparing. I need to be making preparations for the... He's giving you the plan. He's giving you the desire. That's why you're here today. You know why you're here? It's because God has put it in your heart. It's time to begin to build, to prepare. And he works in you not only to will, not only to desire. He says he works in you to will and to do of his good pleasure. See, this is his plan. His plan is not to destroy everyone. His plan is to save some. That's his pleasure. He could have killed all of us, but it's his pleasure to save you. Don't you realize the fact that you've got the will, that you're on the pleasure side of God, that you are pleasing in his eyes? He has a desire to deliver you. And his pleasure, well, he wants to perform that pleasure, not only in giving you a will, but working in you. Doing in you what you can't do yourself. You're not a carpenter. You're a farmer. You're a farmer. You don't know anything about carpentry. Angles. Pitching. What do you know about sea-proofing a vessel? But God knows, and he will work in you. Notice, he's not saying, I will work for you. He will work in you. I know you didn't grow up in Sunday school. I know you don't feel like you're the brightest one, but God will work in you. Everything you need, not only to save your life. You know, it's some men out there. It's some heads of households out there who feel overwhelmed by the task of leading their families into the kingdom. Don't be. Because God will work in you. And he will finish it. It says in chapter 1 of Philippians. Turn back just a chapter. Chapter 1 and verse 6. Philippians chapter 1 and verse 6. Faith. Faith prepares. This is what our theme is. Faith is preparing. It's not just about trusting God to translate you. Faith also prepares. And it prepares not without God, apart from God, but it prepares with God. Here in Philippians 1 and 6, being confident, that's faith, being confident, believing of this very thing, that he which begun a good work in you, by giving you the will to do of his good pleasure, he says, who begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Again, let's read that. Being confident, being in faith concerning this very thing, that he which begun a good work, notice, in you. He started it where? He's working through you. But just like he started working through you, his pleasure is to finish in you. Do you have faith? You know, the question isn't, can you do it? It's daunting when you read the word, when it says, be ye perfect, even as your heavenly Father is perfect. It's daunting when you think about, set your affection on things above and not on things beneath. Don't seek after these things, but seek ye first the kingdom. That's daunting. When you got kids and you need stuff and you're desiring things, and how can I just throw care to the wind and put my trust and my focus in the Lord? It's daunting. Who can win this? Who can do what's being asked of us? He says, when you even hate your brother in your heart, you committed adultery, you committed murder. When you lust in your heart towards the opposite sex, you've committed fornication. Who can do this? Who can please a man like this? The question isn't, can you do it? The question before us, Noah, not whether or not you can build this 300-foot-long ark, but can God do it through you? Do you believe? Will you use your faith to believe that God can not only begin it, but finish it in you? No, not outside of you. He's going to teach your hands how to build it. You're going to cooperate with him in your salvation. Can you believe he could do it through you? Or do you think God's limited by you? Do you think you're the only thing in the universe that can trip up God? God has met his match when he ran into you. Oh, not when he looked at the earth and it was full of darkness, void, refused to participate with his life-giving process. When it had nothing in it, that couldn't stop him. But lo and wait, here it is. In 2009, God has now, after 6,000 years of creation, has now met his match with you. God, you cannot finish this. This is beyond your power. My mind is beyond your power. My attitude, my past, my idiosyncrasies, they're beyond your strength, Lord. You cannot change this. Where is your faith? Being confident. Not in me, but God who works in me. And how is he going to do that? He's going to do this when we fear him. When we fear his name. Let's go back to Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 11. You want to get God to work for you? Do you want to get God to work in you and through you? How do you get God to work through you? How does an individual allow the Lord to work in them, helping them to prepare for their salvation? Hebrews 11 and verse 7 says, by faith Noah, being warned of the things not yet seen, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house. Moved with fear. That's what I want to focus on, because that's the key. You want to get faith off the couch? The only thing that moves faith is fear. Moved with fear. Fear will not only move your faith, it will move your God. What moves God to work for an individual? What moves them? Not just your faith. It's the fear with the faith. It will move you. It will move the God in you. I'll show you what I mean by that in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. The word fear back in Hebrews 11 and 7, it's a special word, fear. It means to take as truth what you hear. It means to take as truth what you hear. To take as the truth. You ever hear something, but you're not sure whether it's you, the Lord, the pizza you had last night? But there are some things that come into your heart that you're confident that this is the truth. You ever have that happen to you? That you were convinced that the thing you just heard, that's the word of God. That's fear. To take as truth. We'll talk about it in just a minute. I want to show you something in 1 Thessalonians 2. Look at the mentality of these individuals in 1 Thessalonians 2 and 13. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13 reads, "For this cause also thank we God without ceasing, because when you received the word of God, which you heard of us, you received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God, which effectually worketh also in you that believe." Very powerful verse here. Paul is telling the Thessalonians that because you receive the word as being the word of God with that same reverence, with that same kind of appreciation, that way you receive the word means that the word you have now received will now work in you effectively because you believe. He's saying that receiving the word in reverence, in fear that it is the true word of God, that's real faith. It will cause that word that you have received to work in you. That's what we're talking about. We can't do this on our own. God's got to work in us. And we're learning here that he works in us through his word and through a word that we have received in fear, reverence, or trust that this is truly the word of God. See, the fear that's talked about back in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 7 is not a fear that causes a person to be afraid to obey God. You ever been afraid? You've been so afraid that you become paralyzed. You run into a friend. You have a friend, and you go over to their home, and you're like, "Well, why aren't you doing this? I'm scared." You would think that if you're scared, you would mount up and fix the thing so you won't have the outcome. But we learn that when we get afraid many times, we become paralyzed, and we can't do it. The fear that's talked about in Hebrews 11 and 7, when it says Noah feared, is not a fear that paralyzes you from obedience. Go with me to 1 Peter chapter 3. Very powerful passage here. When God tells you to fear the Lord, whenever you are admonished in Scripture to fear God, it's not the kind of fear that causes you to be afraid to obey. It's not a fear that causes you to be afraid to obey. If you're afraid to obey, then that fear didn't come from God. It came from the enemy. here in 1 Peter chapter 3, I want you to pay close attention to these passages. If you're not paying attention, pay attention now. Very, very important here in 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse number 1. Likewise, you wives, be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they also may without your words be won by the conversation of the wives or the lifestyles of the wives. Verse 2. While they behold your chaste conversation or lifestyle coupled with fear. This is godly fear. He says you ought to be behaving yourself in your marriage relationship in obedience, in subjection, and with fear. Jump down to verse number 5. For after this manner, in the old time, the holy women also, who trusteth in God, adorned themselves, being in subjection unto their own husbands. The thing he's asking the generations of women today to do is something that all holy women have done. They have adorned themselves, dressed themselves in a spirit of quietness and subjection. And he says they did it trusting God. Now remember what he just said. He's talking not about a woman who's married to a man who's believing, who's kind, who's gracious, who's gentle. He says, if you marry a man who is not a believer, does not walk in a word, does not believe in being long-suffering, who is not gentle but froward, short-tempered, what should you do? Be in fear, but don't let that fear cripple you from obeying. So what kind of fear am I supposed to be in? Don't be in the fear that causes you not to obey. Be in the kind of fear that causes you to trust God, that in spite of this foolish man, God is going to take care of me. And he gives a great example here. Look at the very next verse. It's awesome. Even as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord. He says you need to have the kind of fear that doesn't paralyze you in obedience. You need to have the kind of fear and trust in God that motivates you to obey even when your husband tells you something stupid. You ever read the story of Abraham and Sarah? Abraham tells Sarah, when we go into this town, I need you to lie and say that you are not my wife. Say that you are my sister, because if you tell these individuals that you are my wife, they're going to kill me so they can have you for themselves. Oh, they're not going to commit adultery. They'll commit murder before they'll commit adultery. So lie and say you're my sister. Well, if they will kill you to have me, if you are my husband, what will they do to me if they say you are my sister? If I'm your sister, they're going to take me and make me one of their wives. Somebody say stupid. That's a plan from Pluto. That plan is foolish. If that wasn't the stupidest plan, the only person that plan saves is Abraham. The only person who's coming out on the good end of that plan is you. I'm the one that's going to be taken captive. But he says, be in fear and trust in God. And don't be afraid to obey foolish Abraham, because God will see about you. And we read the rest of the story. She listened. It was stupid. It wasn't going to work, but God made the foolish plan to work. But we don't do that. We get in arguments. Not only with our spouse, trying to convince them that this is a dumb plan, we do this with our spiritual spouse, the Lord. Now, this is stupid. The thing you're asking me to do is ridiculous. I cannot obey this. If I do this, X, Y, Z is going to happen. He says, don't worry, fear. Fear me, trust in me. That the thing that you think is silly and stupid, if you trust in me in fear, you will be delivered. Go to Proverbs chapter 3. See, this is, somebody say faith is fear. It's fear. What is faith? It's fear, but not the kind of fear that paralyzes you to obey. It's the kind of fear that allows you to obey even in the unknown. Faith is the kind of fear that motivates, moves you to obey even in the unknown. Proverbs 3 and verse 5. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not unto thine own understanding, but in all thy ways fear God. Acknowledge him and he shall direct your paths. Be not wise in your own eyes, but what? Fear the Lord. And depart from evil. You know the greatest evil? The Bible says in Hebrews 3, he says, they departed from me with an evil heart of unbelief. He says, do not be wise in your own eyes. Do what I tell you to do. Fear the Lord and flee from evil of unbelief. See, when you fear God, you're not afraid to obey. Even when it doesn't look right. Even when you don't see. Faith isn't plain. Sometimes it confuses you. A lot of people, they believe once they're convinced. But faith sometimes is being convinced even when you don't see it. Even when you don't understand it. It's being convinced because of the source. Fearing God. Believing that the word you receive, that's the word of God. And if God said it, it must be right. Go with me to James chapter 2. It's not the fear that comes upon one in the time of danger. The only fear we know is the fear of reaction. The fear that we feel after we get in trouble. This is not the fear of the Lord. James chapter 2, verse 19. He says, thou believest that there is one God? Well, thou doest well. But the devils also believe and tremble. The devils also believe and fear. Obviously, this is not the God kind of fear that we are to be exercising ourselves in. The fear that demons and devils have concerning God is not the fear that God is admonishing his people to have with him. Now, what's the fear like of the demons and devils? They fear when they're in trouble. Oh, they cut up and do all kind of crazy stuff like the man, the demoniac in Gennesareth, cutting himself. Demons was full of them. And then when Jesus comes off the ship, he said, oh, my bad. You come to destroy us? Oh, I know you're the Son of God. Now he's trying to bow, you know. Now he's trying to confess Jesus. He said, but you weren't doing that when you were cutting the man and having him run around stark naked and robbing people. But soon as they get in trouble, who can beat the demon? Oh, yes, Lord. And that's how some of us are. The only time we fear God is when he come off the ship and he show up and say, oh, yes, Lord, I'm so sorry. I'm a big idiot. Yes, you're right. That's not the fear he's telling us to have. The fear of being caught. The fear once you're in judgment. The fear that's described in Hebrews 11 comes from a word that doesn't mean fear in danger. Instead, it means fear before danger. It means an apprehension of a future fear. That's what God wants us to do. He wants us to fear before the judgment, before the danger, as we would fear when we're in the danger because we heard his warning. It's an apprehension of fear. You ever seen a situation and you knew that thing ain't gonna work out right? You just, that ain't right. Something's gonna happen here. The fear of God is the fear of having received the word. You become cautious. You become tempered before the judgment. It means this. Are you ready? To take the word of God seriously. Not to take his yelling seriously. Not to take the belt, the rod seriously. It means to take his word. You know, God has some children that only takes it seriously when he yells, when he stomps through the house, when he's getting out his belt. But then he has some children who fear his word. When he says stop, they take that word that he ain't playing. It means stop. The fear of the Lord means to take the word seriously. Are we taking the word seriously? Ask yourself, what kind of person are you? Are you, when you come and you hear the word of God time and time again, do you take that word seriously? If so, you are a person of faith. If, on the other hand, you're the type of person that don't believe fat meat is greasy. Anybody know what I mean by that expression? If you don't, see me after service. But anybody who's grew up, look, I may live in Grand Blanc now, but I grew up in the hood. In fact, even if I got hood parents, you know, my parents, they don't play. They like that neck. They used to say, you don't believe fat meat is. People who don't believe the word are people who are not faithful. You're not a faithful person. You're not a person of faith if you do not fear the word. Take seriously the word. Go with me to Luke chapter 12. Let me show you an example of this here in Luke 12. Those who do not take the Lord's warning seriously, they are without true faith. You are without true faith if you do not take the warnings of God seriously like Noah did. You are not a person of faith. You got the faith of demons. They believe and tremble, but only when they're in trouble. That faith will never save you. It's not true faith. It's not the saving faith. True biblical faith, the faith that we're admonished to have, is a faith that fears the warnings of God. People who fear God's warnings, these are people of faith. Here it says in Luke chapter 12, have you found it? We're going to begin here in verse 42. Luke 12 and 42, and the Lord says, who then is that faithful? Who then is that faithful? And why? Which one of my servants is truly in faith? Not just talking it, but truly. Who is that faithful and wise servant whom the Lord shall make ruler over his household to give them their portion of meat in due season? Whew, okay, let's just stop here. If you are a person of faith, if you are such a servant, a faithful servant, God says, whenever you are in need, you're going to have provision. Your meat is going to bring forth in due season, not the season you don't need it, not the season before you need it. In due season, you will always have meat. You will always have provision, both spiritual and natural, if you are a faithful servant. Well, let's find out what it means to be faithful. Because I want to be a person that when it comes time for me to need meat and my family to need provision, I want to make sure that it's there. He says, who is that wise and faithful servant who will have his meat in due season? Verse 43, blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. Of a truth, I say unto you, that he will make him ruler over all he hath. But if that servant say in his heart, my Lord delays his coming, and shall begin to beat the men servants and the maids, to eat and drink and be drunken, the Lord of that servant will come in a day when he looketh not for him, at an hour when he is not aware, and will cut him in sunder, and will appoint his portion, his meat, the thing that you should have had at the right time, he's going to give it to another. Don't you know wealth is never lost, it just changes hands? Has anyone ever told you that? In the time of this country's greatest depression, the Great Depression, the time where people lost everything, was the time where some people got the richest. Wealth does not disappear, it just changes hands. Provision does not disappear, it just changes hands. Will it be in your hands? He's telling us, not if you're not a faithful servant, not if you're not the one who, when you hear the Lord's warnings, you do what he say and you ain't looking around to see if he's looking. But you take seriously his word and not just his presence. He goes on to say here in verse 47, and that servant, are you listening? That servant which knew his Lord's will and prepared not himself, neither did according to his will, shall be beaten with many stripes. Remember our passage, Hebrews 11 and 7. Now by faith, Noah prepared himself for salvation. He prepared for his salvation. He says, that servant who hears my word, knows my will, and does not prepare, that servant will be judged. And that servant is not faithful. They're not a servant of faith. They have no faith. Not the kind of faith that causes you to fear. True biblical faith will cause you to fear, and it will move you to prepare. True biblical faith will not just come down to the altar and cry your eyes out. True biblical faith, real faith, will cause you to fear the warnings and be moved. Not think, not, oh, tomorrow, be moved to prepare when you hear the word. Not when you see him coming, when you hear the word. That's a faithful servant, a servant of true faith.
Amen. Wow. That message is still true today. Did you get anything out of that? Were you blessed? I hope you were. Hope you were blessed by that word on today. I want to pray for you today. Let's take a moment and just pray for those of you out there. Father, we do thank you for your word on today. And Father, we pray that you would put in our hearts that fear we talked about, that we would have the kind of faith that causes and moves us to obedience, not just when we're in trouble, not just when we see judgment come, but Father God, when we hear your voice, when we hear your voice. And Lord, we pray that your Holy Spirit will work in us both to will and to do of your good pleasure, to work out our salvation, work in conjunction with you and your Spirit in completing the work of salvation that you've already begun in us. Lord, we thank you today for your grace. We thank you for your blessing. Again, we thank you for those who are in prayer today, who are a part of this this broadcast. And we thank you that you're bringing them to the end of their faith and the manifestation of your salvation. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen. Praise God. Well, again, we hope that was a blessing to you. Again, we put out a video last Thursday, our Throwback Thursday, and we thought we would come back today on Wednesday. We might call it a Way Back Wednesday and kind of go in the vault and pull out, you know, one of those old sermons. The great thing about the Word of God, you know, it never loses its richness, and we can still apply it today. It's still relevant for us right now. And we hope and pray that you would, you know, listen to these sermons again on YouTube. I mean, on Facebook, if you, or YouTube, you know, if you've watched our videos before, you know, our YouTube channel, our Facebook page, you know, these videos are still on there. Go back, you know, and review some of these messages. And I know they're older, but they'll still be a blessing to you, we believe. Well, we come to a part of our service where we want to invite you and encourage you to share with the Lord an offering, a gift. We know that our time of worship is not just a time of coming together and receiving the word, but worship is also what we do in terms of our giving, our sharing. And so we invite you today to share with the Lord an offering. An offering. We have three ways in which you can give today. You can jump on our website, hmclive.org. Click on the Give Now button there at the top of the menu bar. Or if you have our mobile app, you can jump onto the HMC mobile app right there on the main page. Click on Support, and you'll be able to give that way. And finally, of course, you can send your checks to our P.O. Box, P.O. Box 190017, Burton, Michigan, 48519. And we'll give you a chance, as we always do right now, to take advantage of one of these ways to give, and we'll come back for some final words.
By the hand of the Almighty, I've been set free, healed, delivered, made complete. Now I'm walking in victory. Adrian, won't you help me sing it?
By the hand of the Almighty, I've been set free, healed, delivered, made complete. Now I'm walking in victory.
We're gonna sing that again.
By the hand
got it now. Come on, lift it up.
By the hand, I've been set free. Oh, now I'm walking in victory. Oh, said I'm walking in victory. Said I'm walking in victory. Walking in victory. Give my joy back. Oh, I'm walking in victory. Said I'm walking in. I'm walking in victory.
Praise God. Listen, we have a prayer line. Those of you out there who you are in need of prayer, you desire prayer, we have individuals who are on our prayer line even as I speak right now. And you can jump right on and receive prayer for whatever your need might be. You can dial 351-888-6313. That's 351-888-6313. There's no access code. As soon as you dial that number, you'll be brought right into our prayer room. And as I said, you know, we have elders who are on that call right now, ready to pray with and for you. Listen, we were so glad again to be able to bring you this message. We hope you enjoyed it. If you're on Facebook, leave us a comment saying that you enjoyed it or not. Let us know. the Throwback Thursday, the Way Back Wednesday, if these were a blessing to you. And it was fun. It was fun going back. It was fun seeing a lot of the Saints years ago, even myself. And so we were real pleased to be able to bring you that on today. We'll be back at it again this upcoming Sunday. We look forward to being with you all again. And so we pray that you will have a blessed and wonderful evening. And Harrison Moore, we love you. We're praying for you. Continue to pray for us. Pray for the Saints. We'll see you real soon.
If you would like to hear more sermons by our pastor, simply visit our website at www.hmclive.org. Or you can download the HMC mobile app, available in iTunes Store or Google Play Store. You can also subscribe to our YouTube channel at Harris Memorial. Again, we thank you for watching, and we pray that you will join us again.
How many believe he's worthy tonight?
We praise you, King of glory. We praise you, Prince of peace. We lift our voice to heaven and praise your name. We praise you, King of heaven. We praise you, the Lord of earth. We lift our hands to heaven and praise your name. As you reign in glory, reign in majesty. You reign forever, eternally. We praise you, King of glory. We praise you, Prince of Peace. We lift our voice to heaven and praise your name. We praise you, King of Heaven. We praise you, the Lord of Heaven. We lift our hands. Our hands to heaven and praise your name.
Lord Jesus, tonight all eyes are upon you. So worthy of the worship, so worthy of all our praise.